In 2019, we told you about Buffalo Reef. At the time, the race was on to save the reef before it was buried under mining waste. Well, there have been some developments. So today, we bring you a recap of our 2019 coverage and an update on where the effort to save Buffalo Reef stands today. Here's the story from the Keweenaw Peninsula.
The Keweenaw Peninsula extends into Lake Superior from Michigan's Upper Peninsula, and it's famous for copper. Copper was mined and used by indigenous people at least 8,000 years ago, and copper items from the area were traded across the continent. Later, copper mining became an industry. Dozens of mines produce millions of tons of copper, often by crushing the ore in stamping mills. Before closing in 1932, stamping mills in Gay, Michigan generated 22.7 million metric tons of crushed waste rock, known as stamp sands.
As the rock moves through this mill, it's crushed to a smaller and smaller particle, and then it would separate out the sand from the copper. The copper was a heavier weight, and then the sand would be washed out of the mill, and with high volume of water is sent out as a slurry into Lake Superior.
For roughly a century, wind and waves have been moving the stamp sands across the lake bottom and down the shoreline. The stamp sands now extend along the shore for miles, and in some places cover the natural beach with several feet of black, toxic sand. The stamp sand is also drifting onto Buffalo Reef, an important spawning ground for fish. Great Lakes spawning reefs aren't made of coral. They're composed of rocks the size of baseballs or softballs, and lake trout and whitefish lay their eggs in the spaces between those rocks, where they'll be sheltered and protected, but also bathed in cold, highly oxygenated water. For lake trout and whitefish, Buffalo Reef is one of the most productive reefs in Lake Superior. It's estimated that the Buffalo Reef fishery provides $4.5 million of revenue through commercial and recreational fishing every year. But fishermen in the area have noticed a decline in their catch, and some have had to fish elsewhere. That's partly because the stamp sand is filling in those critical spaces between the rocks. The sand is also a chemical pollutant. Charles Kerfoot of Michigan Technological University has been studying the environmental effects of Michigan's copper mining history in the UP for over a decade.
You have to realize that concentrations of copper are really high, 1,500 parts per million of copper, where the state says 120 can have ecological effects. Let's say you're dealing with orders of magnitude here.
To understand the effects of the stamp sand, Dr. Kerfoot and his team have collected samples from the lake bottom around the reef.
The jaws come in and scoop up a sample of the sand that's on the bottom, of the sediment that's on the bottom. And then we'll take it back and determine under the microscope how many grains are stamp sand and how many are natural. It's a way for us to calculate copper concentration and potential toxicity.
Dr. Kerfoot has shown a direct link between higher concentrations of stamp sands and fewer benthic organisms. These are the bottom-feeding animals that fish rely on for food.
By 50% stamp sands is very serious effect. By 75, it's a desert. There's just nothing down there. If nothing is done within 10 years, 60% of Buffalo Reef will be covered by stamp sands.
That would be a disaster for the four commercial fishing operations that depend on the fish of the Buffalo Reef, including the Keweenaw Bay Indian Community, or KBIC, one of the Native American tribes that has fought to secure federal funding to clean up Buffalo Reef. Evelyn Ravindran is the KBIC's Natural Resources Director.
The Keweenaw Bay Indian Community is a fishing community. It's part of our identity. The loss of that reef would be devastating to our community. If we lose that one, we'll be losing not only parts of the fish population that are here, we're losing all those connections to that area. It's not something that can't be replaced.
In 2017, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency created the Buffalo Reef Task Force, which includes entities from federal, state, and tribal nations.
This has been a big endeavor. As a whole, this is important to everybody. It's been really good to see that so many people consider it to be important and so many agencies consider it important.
The next year, dredging began with the aim of protecting the reef while the task force developed a permanent solution. As a kid, Robert Regis spent his summers vacationing in this area. He's a retired geology professor at Northern Michigan University. Professor Regis did extensive research on the detrimental impact of stamp sands on the environment and has presented his findings to the Buffalo Reef Task Force.
It's been dredged almost yearly for the last 5 years at least, or even more, because of the dramatic stamp sand accumulation there, even into the harbor and beyond to the natural sand side of the bay.
The whole idea of the first stage was to buy time, that we would get enough dredging done in the harbor, we would get enough dredging done in was an old ancient riverbed. And these would be pumped up to the berm complex, which is originally a pond complex along the shoreline set in stamp sands.
The dredging operation was intended to be a temporary fix. And in 2024, after looking at more than a dozen different options, the task force settled on a multi-phased solution for the stamp sand problem.
There's a long-term and a short-term plan. That's several steps. The long-term plan is to remove the sands and put them in a landfill up behind the town of Gay in an upper area.
A spokesperson for the Great Lakes Indian Fish and Wildlife Commission, consisting of 11 area tribes, likes the plan and says it has the best chance of working. That's the result the Great Lakes Indian Fish and Wildlife Commission was pushing for.
The final plan takes the contaminants, the stamp sands, out of the shoreline and off of the lake bed to the greatest extent possible, and it places it in an engineered lined facility away from the lake. It is ultimately a permanent solution to this kind of ongoing and rather serious environmental problem.
The short-term part of the plan, or the first phase, is to construct a jetty that will run on an angle into the lake.
And that will block the movement, the natural longshore movement of stamp sand grains to the south in the natural wave action. But that also limits any of the natural sand from moving south that created the beaches and the harbor in the first place.
And secondly, it will be the transit system from the dredges out in the lake.
The jetty will have a two-lane road large enough to accommodate trucks that will deliver the stamp sands from the dredges to a proposed landfill. That landfill will be located about 2 miles inland from the town of Gay. A critical component of the landfill is a special lining to prevent the toxic stamp sands from leaking into groundwater. The jetty would be dismantled once the stamp sand is in the landfill.
And then they've got to build some kind of a monitoring system and a wastewater treatment system to keep that from polluting the surrounding area.
The mining waste will never go away. So to prevent future pollution, the site will have to be monitored indefinitely. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers estimates the price tag for this plan is more than $2 billion, and it's expected to take 20 years to complete.
Well, you have to realize that the whole thing's been sitting there for a century. I mean, it started in 1900. It ended, the discharges ended in 1932. The darn thing's been sitting around there for us, for over stamp sands, for over a century. If you dump the stamp sand, 22.7 million metric tons, into railroad cars, they would extend from here to San Diego.
I believe the reef will return to its normal habitat and size. Frankly, I'll feel fortunate to be around to see it, given the 20-year span estimated before completion. I have hopes that it will, I believe that it will, and I am satisfied with it, but it will take a long time, definitely.